hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Wonder and worship. Because the reality for all of us is when we truly get a vision of who God is, when we truly understand who He is and what He's capable of, when we truly get to that place of reverence and honor and love for God, the only response we have as human beings is worship. When we understand His wonder, our response as humans is worship. Everybody say it with me, wonder and worship. Say it, wonder and worship. This is why I'm so concerned about our generation, because it feels like we've lost our wonder of who God is. But God is a wonder worker. He's a way maker. He's a miracle worker. He's a savior. He's a healer. Come on, somebody. How many believe that today? Go ahead. Yeah. Ooh, I feel the presence of the Lord. Feel the presence of the Lord in this place. You know, it's good when you come to church and God shows up. That's always good, right? I think sometimes we come to church and God doesn't show up because we don't invite Him. But we invite Him here. We want Him here, right? We want His presence here. We want His manifest presence here. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 17, verse 1 through 8, reading out of the Amplified, this is our text. So read it with me if you will. 6 days later, Jesus took with Him Peter and James and John, the brother of James, and He led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And His appearance changed dramatically in their presence. And His face shone with heavenly glory, clear and bright like the sun. And His clothing became as white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them talking with Jesus. Then Peter began to speak and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good and delightful and auspicious that we are here. If you wish, I'll put up 3 sacred tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And while He was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And a voice from the cloud said, this is My beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased and delighted. Listen to Him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them and said, get up, do not be afraid. And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus Himself alone. You can be seated. I love this passage of Scripture because it gives us an insight into really what was happening in the life of Jesus and the confirmation that God was giving Him, and also the interaction between Him and the disciples. Because when we look at the interaction between Jesus and the disciples, what we really can see is an interaction between God and us, because we're much like them. They weren't some superior people. They weren't some people that were highly educated. They weren't people who were different than us. They were just normal, regular people. And the way that God showed Himself to them through Jesus is the same way that God does that with us today, and we need to understand it, and we need to see how they responded, and sometimes to see how we shouldn't respond, and sometimes to see how we should respond. And so I really love this passage of Scripture. I really think that we live in a time for all of us, even Christians, believers. I think we live in a time where it's very important that we find the wonder we have for God again, that we find that awe for who He is. And the only way I know to get you and I to do that is not by telling you to do it. I could stand up here all day, every day, and preach. You guys need to be in awe of God. You really need to get that wonder back in your life. You really need to be in awe with Him, and you need to respect Him and reverence Him and revere Him because He is God and all of this. And I could tell you to do that, but the only real way to get you to do that is to speak to your heart about who God is. And today what I'm going to do, and for the next few weeks what I'm going to do, is I'm going to speak to your heart about who God is. And I can promise you this, as we begin to discuss who God is, your heart is going to awaken to your need to worship Him. Because when you realize who God is and what He can do and what He's capable of, you can't sit still and say, well, that's good. That's a very good thing. No, you got to say, God, you saved me from my sins. You changed me from every situation. You made a plan for me when there was no plan. You made a way for me when there was no way. God, you are the creator of all things, the king of all things, the most powerful, the most awesome, the most knowing, the most everything. God, you are so good. You are so mighty. You are so powerful. We've got to get to the place where we have that wonder again, so that worship, that true life worship. See, you think worship is about coming to church and raising your hands and listening to the music and singing the songs. No, worship goes far deeper and far farther than that. Worship is something that happens to you when you get up in the morning and when you go to bed at night. Worship is something that happens to you all day long when you recognize who God is. When you see God in something, you just go, hallelujah, that was God. I don't know if you realize it, but there are things happening all around you all day long, every day, that God is doing. You don't even know they're happening. You might want to stop once in a while, look around. I'm going to preach today, y'all, so you just better get used to it. You ought to look around and say, God did that. God did this. God did that. When you look, man, you got up this morning breathing air in your lungs. Come on. God is a miracle working God. You got up this morning. You got your family up. You came to church. You live in a country where it's free to worship God. I've got friends who are hiding right now or last night to have church because they can't do it freely in their country. Come on, somebody. We need to start worshiping God because we serve a wonder-working God. We need to stop worshiping our government. We need to stop worshiping our money. We need to stop worshiping other people. As Connor told me this week, we're having a really good, deep conversation. I don't know where he went. He was raptured. He went to Jesus. He went home. Oh, there he is. He's sitting right there. Like, there's a blank spot right there. You're in my blind spot, Connor. We were talking about just how things are. And it feels like today we're worshiping our opinion. Everybody's worshiping their own opinion. We have an idol of opinion in our home, and we go home and we worship it. Don't I know so much? I am so wise. I just have such great thoughts about everything. I am so awesome. That's how we live our lives. And you say, no, I don't feel that way about myself, but we've seen your social media. And we know you think your word is the word. Come on, somebody. Come on. Don't shout me down because I'm preaching good. The truth is we worship our opinion. Because we think somebody told me one time, you know, the only time opinion is valuable is when it's asked for. Because the only time your opinion is valuable when it's not asked for, it's only valuable to you. Because if no one asks you for it, they're not trying to value. Come on, somebody. Okay, y'all didn't agree with that. It's America. I'll speak my mind. Well, go ahead and speak your mind. And just know that when you speak your mind, everybody's seeing what's in your mind. Amen. I love it because they came together and they were with Jesus, and Jesus was in a very special moment of his life. He was preparing himself to go to the cross. And some translations talk about when this transfiguration happened, that Elijah and Moses came and they shared with him and talked to him about the things he was about to suffer. They basically were encouraging him and undergirding him that he was going to be okay, that we were going to make it through. And so they were having this conversation. So can you imagine being Peter, James, and John, and Jesus calls them as he always does in special moments? It's like Jesus had 12 people that he spent most of his time with, but then when it came to very special moments, he would take Peter, James, and John, those top three, and he would spend time with them. Now, Peter, James, and John all were very important to the cause of Christ, and they were always seemingly at the special things, the transfiguration, the Garden of Gethsemane prayer, all these things. And so we see through them a very intimate relationship with Jesus. And so they go onto this mountain, and Jesus is going up, and I guess to pray, but he took him up there, and the Holy Spirit just shows up. The glory of God shows up. And I mean, it's smoke, and it's bright, and it's unbelievably overwhelming, and Peter and James and John are just like, oh, I mean, what would you be doing? I would be freaking out. I'd be like, man, that what in the world is happening? This is amazing what God is doing. This is amazing what he's capable of. This is amazing what he can do. Look what God can do. And then all of a sudden, in this bright smoke, Elijah and Moses show up. I don't know how they knew who that was, but they just knew it was Elijah and Moses. And that's what was recorded in the scripture. Elijah and Moses showed up. Can you imagine? These guys, a prophet from the Old Testament, another prophet and leader from the Old Testament, a pastor, the pastor of all pastors of the Old Testament, Moses, and then Elijah shows up. Can you imagine what that must have been like? And Peter just got all carried away, as you know he does. Peter always gets carried away because that's exactly how he is. That's his personality. And he's just fed. He's fit to be tied. Oh, my God. Moses, I like that. You know, it'd be like us going and some hero of ours showing up. It'd be like how you would act around some basketball player that you love or football player that you love or wanting to get somebody's autograph. You can't imagine how these boys must have felt about Moses and Elijah showing up. Number one, they were dead. Well, Elijah wasn't, but Moses was. Elijah just went, y'all remember, Elijah just rode to heaven. I want to do that. Can we just make a deal? When you're ready, wouldn't that be awesome if I said that right now and then just whoop, I was gone? Y'all would just freak out. I'm telling you, God is good. And he wants to do good things in us. And he was good in this moment to them. And Elijah and Moses showed up. Now, it's interesting why Elijah and Moses showed up. Because Moses represented the law and Elijah represented the prophets. And what God was saying to Peter, James, and John was, this is the fulfillment of all things in Christ. And they begin to talk and share with them. And then it was too much. Peter just goes, hey, Jesus, this is, it's so funny. Isn't it interesting how we make everything about us? See, this is where worship gets confused. We make everything about us. When you truly see the wonder of God, you don't make anything about yourself, you make it about us. Peter was always making everything about himself. Because what did he say when he saw all of this happening and the smoke coming and God hadn't shown up yet? It was just the glory of God with Elijah and Moses, and the wonder of God hadn't shown up yet, and Peter hadn't seen that yet, but he was all excited about what was going on. Moses and Elijah's here, and he just got excited, and he turned to Jesus and he looked at Jesus and he said, isn't it good for us to be here? Isn't that just like us? Man, it's so great that I'm here. Church can start now. I'm here. Come on. You can have the party now. I showed up. Isn't it interesting, though, and I'm not being critical or condemning. I'm not condemning in any way. Here's what we have to realize. If we're truly going to get into that place of wonder with God, our perspective, the way we see things, our view has got to come off of us and go on to him. It's got to be that moment where we stop looking at ourselves and we start looking at him. This is why I say to you all the time, when you're having problems or issues or circumstances, stop looking at your problems, issues, and circumstances and start looking at the God who is able to do whatever needs to be done for those problems and issues and circumstances. We sit and talk about them and worry about them and stress them. But come on, get your eyes off the problem. Get your eyes on the problem solver. Come on, somebody. And we got to get our eyes off of ourselves and get our eyes on him. And when we start having that wonder of who he is again, then worship starts pouring out of us. Now, you think that's not true. Watch what happens next. Papa shows up. The Bible says a bright cloud overwhelmed them. Have you ever been in the dark and just be overwhelmed by the dark and a foggy? Have you ever been driving on fog and the fog is there and it's dark and you just feel all closed in and you just feel like, I mean, I can't see anything? What do you think that's like to feel closed in and overwhelmed by the light? And it was broad daylight and all of a sudden this light completely overshadowed every other light. And it just descended on them And God basically said, Peter, this would be a good time to shut it. Isn't what he said? He said, be quiet. This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. In other words, he's saying, Peter, you stop talking now. This is what you're doing. This is what I want you to do. Stop talking now and listen, because what's about to be said is what you need to hear. When we get that awe of God, we stop talking so much and start listening to what God is saying. Worship isn't just about, God, I need this. God, I want that. God, I need this. God, just do this. God, moving. God, I need you to hear me, God. And God, it's good that I'm here because your presence is, and I know you're blessed. Come on, we need to get it to where it's not about any of that. It's just like, God, I'm here in your presence. Show up in my life. Do what you want to do. Have your way in me and just bask and listen. And here's what the Bible says. When that brightness came over, when Papa showed up and he said, everybody be quiet. Listen to the Son. I'm well pleased in the Son. The Bible says they hit the dirt, y'all. They were terrified. Now, I love the use of that word. I love the use of that word. Because we're so busy trying to convince everybody that we shouldn't fear God. And don't misunderstand me, because we're in the New Testament, and if we believe in Jesus and we're walking in the grace of God, because if you're not have that relationship, you're not walking in the grace of God. I know there's a lot of people who think you are, because this is just the age of grace. Listen, if you're, the Bible says in John chapter 3 that if you are not following Jesus or born again, you are condemned already. Jesus doesn't need to condemn you. You're already condemned. That's why Jesus doesn't condemn and point an accusing finger. But he calls you to love and calls you to grace. And so if you're walking in the grace of God, you need to understand you're not overwhelmed by this. You can walk into the presence of God. You can talk to him without fear or without being afraid of him. Like, oh. But in the essence of not being afraid of God, we have somehow stopped fearing God. Do you understand what I'm saying? Somehow we have gotten to the place where we're not afraid of him, but we've stopped reverencing him. I'm not talking about religious, ritualistic reverence. I'm talking about wonder worship. I'm talking about like, oh God. Like this morning when we were in praise and worship, I couldn't stand up any longer. I had to kneel down. Why? Not because everybody was supposed to kneel down, but because in my heart at that moment, the Holy Spirit was just ministering to me, and I just had to kneel down because I just wanted to say, God, I need to be low because you are high. I need to be down here because I want to be submitted to you. I want to be in reverence of you. I want to honor you. We cannot lose that reverence. They were terrified. Because here's the bottom line. Even if you're covered by grace, even if you're in relationship with Jesus, if God himself in his manifest presence, full glory, physically showed up in here today, even just the little essence of who he is, you wouldn't be going, oh, there's Papa. You would hit the dirt and say, I don't know what just came in here, but it's bigger than me, and I'm going to get down here until it tells me I can get up. Now, I'm not saying to look at God as some force or looking at God as some overwhelming. No. I'm just saying he loves us so much. He cares for us as much. He's so graceful. But that's our God. He is amazing, and he is powerful, and he is wonderful. And here's why we should think of him that way. Here's why we should fear him, reverence him. Not be afraid of him, but fear him and reverence him. Why? Why should we do that? Why is it important? Even more so now. Because it's in that atmosphere that God can truly move among us and do things that he wants to do. The Bible says if you want God to come near you, go near to him. The Bible says submit yourself therefore to God and he will lift you up. Too much of people lifting themselves up and God having to put them down lately. I know we don't talk a lot about this anymore, but that's the character and nature of God. Sometimes we feel like, man, I was really humiliated. God, you worked those circumstances out where I really didn't come out looking great. Well, you probably shouldn't have put yourself up there. So good. Oh, y'all smile at me. It's okay. So in that moment, Jesus says, God says, be quiet, listen to Jesus. And the wonder of God overtook them, and they hit the ground terrified. The word terrified there, they were just shaking in their boots. They were like, oh, this is God. You remember when Moses said, God, I want to see you. Now, this is pre-redemption, pre-born-again experience. That's exactly what these disciples hadn't been born again yet, right? Their spirit man had not been renewed yet, right? They were still in the Old Testament, under the Old Testament. They were not. Jesus hadn't died. He hadn't come again from the grave. So none of that had happened yet. So they were still living in that system. And so that's why they were so afraid. But remember when Moses said, God, I just want to see you. I just want to see you. Because, you know, he would see the manifestation of God's presence and his glory, and God would show up and he would give him things, and he would go back down off the mountain and he would share that with the people. And one day the people said, we want to listen to God. We want to see God. Let Moses, who are you? Why should you get to tell us what God is saying? We want to hear God for ourselves. And so God sanctified him for a while, and he told Moses to come up on the mountain, and Moses came up on the mountain, and Joshua hid in the cleft of the rock. He didn't know what was going to happen. He's like, I ain't going too close. And God said, don't even let an animal touch this mountain, because it's sanctified, and if an animal even touches it, they die immediately. So then God starts talking, and everybody hears it. All the children of Israel, they hear it. Just God's voice booming out of the mountain. And they see the glory of God descend on the mountain. And you know what they did when Moses got down off the mountain? You know what they said? Hey, Moses, why don't you go ahead and tell us what God said? We just don't need to hear him anymore. We don't need to hear him. Why? Because he was so powerful, it was too much, and they were so sinful. Listen to me. Jesus, the reason we need to see God with such reverence, because it makes what he did for us that much greater. When you see God for who he really is, this holy, wonderful, wonder-working, magnificent creator, king of all things, universal God, nothing exists outside of him, nothing was created outside of his hand, he absolutely is an amazing God who not only created all things, but all things in him consist, the Bible tells us in Colossians. He is powerful and wonderful and omniscient and omnipresent and omnipotent. There's no power he doesn't have, nothing he does not know, and nothing he can't do. Come on, he's always everywhere all the time. God is every bit of what you think he is, and so much more that you couldn't and I couldn't even comprehend or understand. And if we really see him in that light, then when we understand redemption and that Jesus came and gave his life for us so that we could be saved, it makes us understand all the more how blessed we truly are, that Jesus loved us enough to change the circumstances, to pave the way, to make a lane for us to get to God. Hallelujah. In the significance of the transfiguration, what happened is all the fulfillment of the law and the prophecies came together in Jesus, and they encouraged him to move forward with the purpose of God. And if we're paying attention, God will reveal his greatness to us. When we see it, we have but one response. There have been moments in my life where God showed up so big that there was nothing left to do but just to stop and worship. I don't know if you've ever had any moments in your life like that, but if you haven't, you need to have some. Well, how do I have moments? I'd love to have moments like that. Well, first you got to pray. First you got to fast. First you got to put yourself in position for that. First you got to stop being so distracted by life. Come on. And put yourself in position for God to do something like that in your life. You know, when God, I've told this story before, but when we were coming around a corner, in a dark corner, in our little RAV4 that we had at the time, and we were coming around a corner, and a guy had stolen a Lexus, and he had come off the highway and come around this same corner in our lane, and we turned that corner. There was no light on the corner. All we could see is his headlights 10 feet in front of us and cops' lights behind him chasing him, and he was in our lane, and there was nothing left to do. There was no time left. There was no opportunity left. There was nothing left. We couldn't do nothing. There's no way for me to respond. I couldn't do nothing, and anything that I would respond to do would only make the wreck worse, because that narrow base on that RAV4 would just flip us over if we hit that curb. I knew it in my mind, and when I saw that guy barreling down on us. You know how you see a car that's kind of sucked down to the road? That's how fast he was going. He's going 90 miles an hour, and he was taking that curve at every bit of that speed. And he came straight for us. And all I know is I closed my eyes and I said, Jesus, help us. That's all I said. That's all I did. I couldn't do anything else. My wife was sitting in the car seat next to me. My baby was in the back seat. We were going back to pick up Taylor at an event. And all I know is I felt the glance of his car on our car. But the next thing I know, when I opened my eyes, we were setting up on the curb. He never left our lane. The cops came back and said, I have no clue what just happened there or how that happened. How did he miss you? But you know what? We sat in that car and we knew exactly how he missed. I didn't care that there were scratches all the way down the car. I didn't care that there was a mirror gone in that car. We sat there on that curb and tears running down our face. We lifted up our hands and we said, we worship you, God. Because in this moment of our personal crisis, you cared enough in all of your immensity to look down on the Gadberries and say, it's going to be all right. I'm just going to push you over here. If we're paying attention to his greatness, we see it, we have but one response: worship. Psalms 34:3 says, glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Psalms chapter 48, verse 1 says, great is the Lord and most worthy of praise in the city of our God, in his holy mountain. Can you understand today that the reason we worship God is not because it's our duty? The reason we worship God is not because it's what you do at church. The reason we worship God is not just because that's what you're supposed to do as a Christian. The reason we worship God is because he's worthy. The very word worship comes from the word worth-ship. God is saying to us, when you see my goodness and what I've done for you, lift up my name and glorify me, because I'm worthy of your praise. I'm worthy to receive your adulation. Because what happens, this is why God wants us to worship him. When we worship him, it puts us in proper perspective to him. Are you with me, y'all? Come on, we ought to shout down. We ought to stop and just give God a hand clap of praise right now. Come on. He's worthy. I'm going to go farther than this and make us all mad. Even if he never did a thing for you, he's still worthy. Even if he never saved your soul, he's still worthy. Even if he never healed a sick person, he's still worthy. Even if he never saved you from disaster, he's still worthy. Why? Because he's God. And we better get back to the idea and understanding that he made us. The Bible said in Psalms, I believe it's 138, it says, you are beautifully and wonderfully made. David said, I was beautifully and wonderfully made. God, your works are great. I know this very well. He was bragging on himself. He was bragging on God about himself. God, I'm beautiful. You did good. It may not have been that conceited. But the truth is, God, the Bible says, put us together. Our mothers, oh, I know, the seed and the egg met and you developed over time. But let me tell you something, if it wasn't for the inspirational hand of God that began all that several thousand years ago in the Garden of Eden, when he took Eve out of Adam and then gave them children and said, be fruitful and multiply. That is the system, and that's God's hand. And God said, David literally telling us that when we are in our mother's womb, God's hand is in it. He crafted us together. When you see the power of God, you have no other option but to worship. Do you remember the three Hebrews? Do you remember them? Do you remember when they were in the Old Testament, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do you remember them? Do you remember what they were going through? Do you remember these were 17, 18-year-old boys? Maybe. Do you remember that they were going through struggles about how they were going to worship? That the king of that time stood up and said, worship, I'm going to build this idol and everybody has to worship this idol. It's the idol of me. I want you to worship at that idol. And when the music plays, everybody in the nation better bow down and worship this idol. Everybody, no exceptions, everybody. And these guys had been taken from Israel. They had been taken from their home country. They were now living in a place. They had been because they were blessed and they were graced with wisdom and intelligence along with Daniel, they were put in a group of men who are being crafted and developed to be leaders of this great kingdom. And as they were in this, you could say that they were betraying what they were being gifted for. Because there's a time in our lives that no matter what anybody else says, we got to choose God. It doesn't matter who says it. It doesn't matter what authority says it. It doesn't matter who speaks out and says, this is the way it's got to be, and this is what you have to say, and this is what you have to do. This is where you have to be on this, and this is how you have to think. Listen, I don't care what anybody says. I'm going to tell you how I'm going to think. I'm going to think how this says to think. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to say. I'm going to say what this has to say. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to do what he tells me to do. Come on, somebody. And this is where the Hebrews were. And they were standing here, and everybody else, when the sound of the trumpet and the sound of the flutes and the sound of all the music began to declare, bow before this idol, everyone bowed. And here are these young men standing. I'm not bowing. Now you have to understand what they were threatened with was a fire. They were not threatened with, we're going to persecute you. They were not threatened with, we're going to treat you bad. They were not threatened with, we're going to say something bad about you on Facebook. They were not threatened with, we're going to sue you. They were threatened with, see that fire over there? We're going to throw you in it. You're going to die. And so it's exactly what they did. They decided, look, we're going to give you one more chance. They came to three Hebrews and they said, we're going to give you one more chance before you. You've all heard this in children's church. It might do you good to go back and read it again. You may have forgotten about how big and how awesome and how powerful God is. And this isn't some fairy tale that you read out of some Disney book. This is the Bible. This is the Word of God. This is real. These people were in bondage. These people were enslaved. These people were not allowed to do what they normally would do. But in the moment of pressure, see, it's not pressure. It's not that everybody will say that in pressure, that's when a man is made. That's when you develop the character. No. I got news for you. It's not pressure does not develop character. Pressure reveals character. If you're waiting for a pressured situation before you're going to show everybody your character, I got news for you. You're going to be just as limp then as you are now. Oh, man, when I hit the lottery, I'm going to start giving. You ain't giving when you're making $100 a week. You ain't giving when you make $1 million. Oh, y'all, come on. You can do better than that. That's right, Pastor. Come on. I'm going to be more committed one day when I have more time. No, unless you make more time and get more committed, it ain't going to happen. But when the pressure's on, I'm going to really dig into God. No, you better dig into God now. So when the pressure gets on, it just comes out of you. It's so easy. You better know it before you get there. You better prepare before you get there. You don't want to get in the middle of the battle and start putting your armor on. You better put your armor on right now, somebody. You better get it on. You better get that helmet of salvation on. You better get that sword of the Spirit in your hand, the Word of God. You better get your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace and the belt of truth around your waist. And you better go into battle. You better be ready for battle. You better just wake up in the morning saying, devil, I don't know if today's the day, but if it is, you're going to get the whooping of your life. Come on, somebody. Come on. I said something so important to the king. The king said, hey, if you don't bow this time, we're going to heat it up 7 times hotter, and we're going to throw you in. And they said something so important to the king, and it's not something that we have enough down deep in our spirit. We need to get it in there. They said, oh, king, we will not bow to your idols. But before they said that, they said, our God can deliver us. Listen what they say. Our God can deliver us. But even if he doesn't. Oh, wait a minute. So this relationship we have with God, so much of the time that we don't really wonder about him. We don't really have this awe of him. We're not really in reverence of him. Come on. And we think that our relationship with him is all about, well, God's doing this for me, so I'm going to do this for him, or God's going to do this, and I'm going to do that. Listen, that is not the way this works, y'all. We have to have that deep inner conviction that we've known the wonder of God so greatly, because these boys had heard stories These boys had heard about Red Sea crossings. These boys had heard about miracle-working manna coming from heaven. These boys had heard about what God was able to do to the walls of Jericho. They weren't just operating on nothing. They knew what their God was capable of. And the wonder that they had for God caused worship to rise up with them. And they said, no matter what, God can deliver us from your fire, O King Nebuchadnezzar. But let me tell you something. Even if he doesn't, we are not going to bow. And so, the king gave up. The three Hebrews went home, and they all lived happily ever after. No. It doesn't really usually happen like that, does it? Sounds good, and it makes a great Disney movie. But it normally doesn't happen that way. King said, all right, you chose it. And they said, take them, put them in the fire. The fire was so hot that the people carrying them to the fire were burned up by the fire. Now listen what happened. They go in the fire. And they should immediately be killed. They should immediately die. They should immediately be destroyed. They should immediately just scream out, writhing in pain. Can you imagine being killed by being put in fire? They should have immediately just been trembling and shaking and consumed by the fire, but nothing, literally nothing happens. Because nothing happens, the king gets up and he goes over to the fire. See, this is what's so powerful about God. I wish I could get you to understand again that God does miraculous things. I wish I could get you to understand again that the power of God can supersede any problem in your life or any circumstance in your life. I wish I could get you to understand again that God is bigger than what you think he is, and he's more powerful than what you've acknowledged, and he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think according to his power that works in you. Come on, somebody. I'm telling you, you got to see God with a different lens today. Some of y'all look at this man has lost his ever-loving mind. No, you know what? I haven't lost my mind. I've got my mind. And my mind says, my God is so big, I'm going to worship him. But we're reserved. You know what? I imagine about people who are so reserved, you haven't asked God to do something big enough yet. You haven't experienced the things. Don't mock me because I worship God with all my heart. Don't you do it because mock me because I lift my hands. Don't think I'm weird because I get, you don't know what I've gone through. You don't know what God saved me from. You go to a football game and lift up your hands to that God of the football. Come on. You go to a basketball game and I lose your mind. I've been there. I'm right there with you. I was on the football field this weekend, losing my ever-loving mind. But I am not going to serve my God, who is so far surpasses anything on this planet, with some kind of halfway, I got to watch my language right here, halfway attitude towards, you say, you watch your language. Sometimes, y'all, the devil irritates me. Going to give some halfway to God. They tried to do that in the Old Testament. They started the Bible said, bring the best sacrifice to God. Bring the best lamb to God. Bring the best goat to God. Bring the best. And they started giving God the poked out eyes, blind goats and poked out eyes, lame sheep, and bringing that to God because that was the last. That's what they had left over. God said, I ain't receiving it anymore. You keep it. Well, we live under grace. So we think grace makes the expectation of our behavior less? Well, God loves us and he cares for us, so he doesn't care if we worship him. God cares for us and he loves us and he covers us, so he doesn't care that we are in awe of him. That attitude cannot be in us. Well, I don't think that way, Pastor, but what do our actions say? Do you really understand the wonder of God? These three Hebrew boys put it all on the line, not because they were so brave, but because they understood the power of their God. And they knew that even though they may die in that fire, they were going to be in the presence of their God. And it didn't matter what happened here. It only matters what happens there. And they were so excited to do it. I'm just going to go in. We're going to go in. And the king jumped up off of that throne, and he looked in, and he said something very precarious. I see. Didn't we throw three men in the fire? Didn't we throw three men in the fire? I see four men. And one looks like the Son of God. One looks like someone who is all powerful. One looks like someone who is amazing. The one looks like the King of all kings. And why are they walking around? Can you imagine how? Can you imagine? Let me tell you what happened as a result of that. The boys walked out of the fire. I would love to have been there. How many of y'all would just love to have been there? Some of y'all are like, well, I wouldn't so much wanted to be in the fire, but it would have been great to observe it from the outside. But I would have loved to have walked out of that fire. Can you imagine the looks on people's faces? The Bible literally says that they came out, they weren't singed, they weren't burned, they weren't harmed, they weren't hurt. They didn't even smell like smoke. You can't go into a quick stop and not come out not smelling like smoke. Come on, somebody. It is amazing what God can do. That in our direst circumstances, in our most difficult places, if we'll put our faith in Him, if we'll trust in Him, we'll look at His wonder and His power and His might, get our eyes off of our circumstances, raise the level of your vision beyond the horizon, get it up there where it belongs, stop looking down, stop looking at your circumstances, stop looking at your problems, stop looking at those issues that are keeping you down or holding you back, and just put your eyes up and just begin to look at the God who can defeat every giant, who can bring down every mountain, who can raise up every valley, who can heal every hurt, who can bind up every wound. Come on somebody. Our God is bigger. Our God is greater. Our God is higher than any other. Come on. And when you know Him, you're going to come out okay. Why? Because He's with you. The Bible says in Isaiah, you may walk through the fire, but you will not be burned because I am with you. You can walk through the water, the floods that overflow you, but you will not drown because I am with you. Well, Pastor David, what happens if I go in the fire and burn up? You will be with Him. I'll close with this. I was in Rwanda, Africa. And I don't know if you ever had amoebic dysentery, but I don't recommend it. We were doing a medical clinic in a community in Rwanda that was the prostitution district of Rwanda. So there were kids running around, there were women running around, there were men all over the place, and it was a disgusting place. It was dirty. And we said, we're having a medical clinic. We're going to disperse medicines. We had doctors. Literally, President Kagame's doctor was there to help us that day. And we had five or six doctors, and the leading expert in Africa for HIV/AIDS was there. It was a great day. People lined up forever. These kids were so precious and so sweet, just running around playing. We had things for them, but most of them were sick and didn't even know it. 95% of them had AIDS. And I got to playing with them. I can't help myself. You know, you just get around kids who need so bad. You got to love them. You got to love them. You can't just look at them and observe them and say, oh, this is bad. You got to do something. And so as we were doing the medicine, I was out with the crew that was blowing up balloons and giving, you know, stuff away and playing games and all this. And I was playing with this kid and several kids, and they were shaking my hands and, you know, just germs everywhere. And I teach the teams that we take a regiment of, this is how you stay clean, this is how you keep from getting sick, this, and you do this. And every single thing I said to not do, I did. Everyone, I just totally lost myself. And then I went and got lunch and for the team. Me and several others of the team went and got lunch for everybody, and we got something. It's just a delicacy. It's just a delight from heaven called a sambosa. It's just a fried pocket of meat. It is like if God ever needs to feed us in the wilderness, Lord, let that be the manna that you send. It was just so good. I don't know if you've ever had it, but I've had it in Asia. I've had it in Africa. I've had it in South America. I'm just telling you, America, we need to get together and create our version, not some frozen thing in the quick stop. Come on. But I went to get these, and we brought them back. And I dispersed them. I didn't touch any of them. You're like, you're about to make your whole team sick. I didn't touch any of them, but I touched mine, and I ate with my hands, and I forgot to put Germex on. I forgot. I got so sick. It's the only time I've ever truly thought I was going to die. And I'm not lying to you. I'm not exaggerating. I'm not being hyperbolic with my speech. I thought I was going to die. And days. It went on for days. And I'd been sick before overseas, and I thought, well, it'll pass in a couple of days, and we'll get a doctor up here. And we got doctor, and we got medicine, and it just didn't stop. And I was dehydrated, and I was just sick and sick and sick and sick. And you know how when you're sick and you relieve yourself, but you don't feel better? That's how amoebic dysentery is. You never feel better. You never feel like you're relieved or like it's going to be okay. Or I'm telling you, I rolled in that bed. I hurt. I prayed. And I mean, days. It was bad. And I was on medicine, and I thought, come on, this has got to kick in. Something's got to happen. We got to the day before we were about to come home. Now, let me just, there's no more anxiety in the world than thinking about, how am I going to get to an airport? How am I going to get through traffic? How am I going to get on that plane and drive 10 hours or fly 10 hours to the next plane that's going to be 10 hours and get home? This is craziness. How am I even going to get out of this hotel? I was about to lose. My family's never going to see me. I was literally thinking about sending messages to my family or writing notes to be sent back with the team. I didn't come home. I didn't make it back. I was that sick. And I didn't know this, but I had told the team, go do what you're going to do today. I'm just going to lay here. And one of the team, we had nurses there as well as doctors, and they stayed back because they just didn't feel comfortable leaving me by myself. And so they stayed back in the room, and everybody else left. And I told them, go do your normal thing. But what I didn't know is they didn't. Some of them were staying in the room below my room. And they went and got in that room, and they got in a circle. And for hours they prayed. They prayed and they prayed and they prayed. And I didn't know they were even down there. But they just prayed, God, heal our leader. God, we got to get home. God, this is bad. What are we going to do? This is not good. This is not, maybe it's something else. We didn't know what, maybe it's not what we thought it was. You know, all of this, it was so bad. I mean, I really thought this is it. And I just remember in that moment, there was a moment in time where all of a sudden the fever just broke and I just began to sweat profusely. And I just went like this, went, and I'm telling you, in that moment, I felt that disease, whatever it was, just leave my body. And you know what I did? I didn't get up and say, wow, that's over. Glad that's over. I knelt by my bed and I lifted up my hands. I said, thank you, Jesus. You see, because even though we worship Him because of the wonder we have for Him, what makes Him so wonderful is that He's that amazing. Yet in my little sickness, in my little bed in Africa, He knelt down beside me and just put His hand on me because of some praying people who cared about me. He heard their cry and He healed me. Listen, when you truly see the wonder of God, your only response is worship. Stand with me. That's how we're going to end today. I'm just going to lift our hands up and we're going to worship. Just for the next couple of minutes, then we'll dismiss you, give your announcements, and let you go. But I'm asking you to do something with me right now. Janae and I and our family, we're going through some things right now. I don't tell you that because I want your pity. I don't tell you that because I want you to feel sorry for me or I want you to feel weird about your pastor. I'm telling you that because you're my family and we believe in prayer. And we're going through something we've never had to go through before with the sickness of her dad. We've never had to go through something like this close to us. But it's an opportunity for God to do something significant in our lives and the lives of our family. And we're not going to let it go. And you know when you get in a situation like this, how the devil will pile on? You know, when you get in a hard situation, the devil will pile on. And he'll just make you start thinking things that you shouldn't be thinking. He'll start making you aggravated. And he'll start making you frustrated. He'll start making you get distracted. And he'll start making... And I've just resolved in myself this morning. No. My eyes are going to stay above the horizon. My eyes are going to stay where God wants my eyes to be. My eyes are going to see the Canaan land. We might be in the wilderness right now, but it's just over there. We might be in the wilderness right now, but it's just over that mountain. It's just over that horizon. Come on. And if you're there today, here's what I want you to do. If you're struggling, if you're having some kind of problem, some having coming out, or you're not at all, and life is very good for you at the moment, just listen to me, listen to me. That's when you need to worship the most. That's when you need to worship the most and invite the presence of God in your life the most so that you can be geared up when you face something that's hard. So here's what I want you to do today. I want you to stop worrying about every other thing, religious thoughts, opinions, people, everything else. And I want you just to take a minute and just absolutely forget about everything else and worship God. Just out of your heart, lift up your hands with no, I'm not going to try to fire you up. Just worship God. Just see the wonder of who He is. And worship Him. It's going to change your life.